Thank you very much, Director Zuhairi.
Pleasure.
Welcome. Okay. I'm very happy to meet you this morning. It is a great honor for me to talk for the first time in this prestigious center. As Ambassador Zuhairi said, I think we are staying together for 1 hour. No? So I propose to you to make an introduction about 2 points. The history of social, economic, and cultural human rights, and then the problematic of one specific social and human rights, the right to food. The right to food. So if you agree, I should speak what? 30 minutes, 35 minutes?
To you.
No, you. Okay, 35 minutes and then we have a talk and you...
See.
So, the history of human rights is a very strange history. It's not at all self-evident. You know that the term United Nations was forged by the Allied powers in Second World War at the conference of Tehran in 43. For the first time, Roosevelt, Churchill, Stalin spoke, we, the United Nations, the Allied powers who fought fascism, who fought Nazism and the Japanese imperialism. 43 was the year, 1943, where the war changed completely. The war was victorious for the Germans, the Japanese, until 43. And then came Stalingrad in the east, and there came El Alamein, in North Africa, where the German armies were broken. So, since through the conference of Tehran, of Yalta, and of Potsdam, there was the term of United Nations. And the victorious power said, when the victory is achieved, then we are creating the United Nations. They won, you know, the Second World War was terminated 8th of May 1945, and 1 month later already, June 45, the United Nations were constituted. The founding Congress was in San Francisco in June 45, and there came together every state in the world who declared war to the Axis powers, the fascist powers, against the fascist powers, before the 8th of May 45. There were 43 founding delegations, 43 founding delegations in San Francisco, who adopted the Charter of the United Nations, which today is in vigor. The assembly was quite strange. Naturally, the big victorious powers, France, Russia, Soviet Union, Great Britain, America, and so on, were there as the dominating powers. They are still the veto power now in the Security Council, the executive power of the United Nations. But there was also Honduras, Brazil, and so on. Countries who just in the last months of the war declared war against Nazi Germany. And what is a strange thing? These powers, who lost almost 60 million young men, women in the war, in the Second World War, these victorious powers were not able to make an agreement on the definition of human rights. Also, they fought fascism, Nazism, the most horrible totalitarian powers in the world at this time, in the name of human rights, of self-determination, of international solidarity, and so on and so on, they were not able to draw a catalogue of and to define human rights. Why? For one simple reason, the Western powers, the Americans, the British, the French, and so on, they said, there is one block of human rights priority, the civil and political rights. which means right to assembly, right to freedom of thought, right of expression, right freedom of religion, and so on. The classical political and civil rights. And there were the communist states, also among the victorious powers, very, very, very powerful at this time, which said, this is hypocrisy. First the people have to eat, to go to school, to have medicine and so on, and then they can think of press freedom, of freedom of consciousness and so. And they said, first we have to give priority to the social, economic and cultural human rights. And the two blocks just collided and paralyzed themselves. There is to make it quick, there is a very famous historical exchange documented in the founding assembly, where the British ambassador said to the Soviet ambassador, we don't want well-nourished slaves. We don't want well-nourished slaves. And the Soviet ambassador answered, even free men can die from hunger. So the conflict was totally paralyzing, The accusation was naturally, the Western power said, the communists, they don't want to have freedom of expression because they don't want to have democracy. They are totalitarian regimes, they won't have democracy. And the communist power said to the Western power, you are complete hypocrites. For there is a famous phrase also of the Soviet ambassador, bulletin, how do you say bulletin? Voting, when you vote, you put in the...
The voting process?
No. You put into the, with the name of the country. A voting bulletin,
ballot.
A voting ballot is not nourishing the hungry. You cannot eat the voting ballot. And for an analphabet who cannot go to school, press freedom means nothing because he cannot read. You know? And the communists said to the Western powers, you are hypocrites. You just want this formal political civil rights because you don't want social justice. You don't want the people to get culture, to get food, to get and so on. So the United Nations Founding Assembly found a compromise. They instituted a commission and said, we come together later and this commission will work a catalogue of human rights, and later on we will see what will happen. And they just adopted the charter. And in the charter there are no human rights, which is incredible for the victorious power who came out of a butchery, you know, of the most horrible war, world war the planet ever knew. So the commission was founded. It was the Commission of Human Rights, which lasted then until 2005, September 2005. And 3 years later, 1948, in Paris, at the General Assembly of the United Nations Paris, was adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, this one. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This is in French, because we live in Geneva, but you don't understand French. The 30 articles were adopted. And these 30 articles contain almost exclusively civil and political rights, because the two chairmen of this Commission of Human Rights were Eleanor Roosevelt and were Maurice Cachin, a French professor, and the wife, the widow then at this time, 48, of the American president, Delano Roosevelt. And both of them, Madame Roosevelt and Cachin, they lived in the American and in the French tradition. So the first human rights declaration of modern times was 1776, 4th of July 1776. The Declaration of Independence in Philadelphia of the United States of America. begins with a catalogue of human rights. With a catalogue of human rights. It's the first international document worldwide which defines the human rights. 1776. Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, the Grounding Father, wrote this down. And the first article which disappeared from this from this document is a beautiful beautiful article, but just disappeared from history. It is the first article is of the American Declaration, the right to seek its own happiness, the right to the pursuit of happiness. And alinea 2 of this article says, and if the government is impeding the search, you have to overthrow the government. This the Americans should read again from time to time, you know. You should abolish the government. Then came the French Revolution, 1789, August 1789. And the French revolutionary just copied the American Declaration. The French Declaration is called Déclaration des droits de l'homme et du citoyen. They don't speak about women. Et du citoyen, I'm sorry, it was the time. About the, so, and which copied almost completely without Article 1. So the United Nations, the 30 articles of the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 48, Paris 48, there were 68 states already. So 68 states participated and adopted this Declaration of Human Rights. But two-thirds of humanity still lived under colonial rule. Mm. This has to be said, you know. When we come to the discussion, I can tell you why Arab countries, why African countries, Algeria and so on, they are very critical about this declaration. The Algerian ambassador Dembélé said, what is this declaration? My brother was killed in 48 under torture, you know, by the French occupation. Why should they respect this? And so on. Okay. So there were 68 states who adopted this. But what is the most important? The 30 articles are almost exclusively inspired by the American and French tradition of the two preceding declarations because of the co-chairmanship of Roosevelt and Cachin, and contains almost exclusively civil and political rights. So the discussion was blocked, still blocked. The Universal Declaration was adopted, but the discussion on human rights was still blocked. Then came August 1991, and the Soviet Union broke down, dissolved itself. In my view, this was a good thing. They were communist as I am Buddhist, you know. It was a police dictatorship in the Kremlin. It was not communism at all, but still. Until the implosion of the Soviet Union, one human being on three on this planet lived under communist rule. So there was bipolarity of the state society. In 91, there was a very intelligent Secretary General of the United Nations, which was not the case every time, but this one was very intelligent. Boutros Ghali, Egyptian professor, Coptic Egyptian professor. And he seized occasion. He said, now it's the occasion to reconcile the two camps. Now it's the And he convoked to Vienna the Great Conference on Human Rights, 1993, 2 years after the implosion of the Soviet Union. 2 years is very short for the bureaucracy of the United Nations. It's very short. And Boutros really pushed this conference, 93. And in 93, the Vienna Convention adopted the catalogue of the social, economic and cultural rights, and decided in the final resolution that from now on, civil and political rights and social, economic and cultural human rights will be universal, indivisible and interdependent. This was the decision on Vienna. And since then, the since then there is universality of the two types of human rights. If you look at UN documents generally, you have the expression rights of the first generation, rights of the second generation. Rights of the first generation are civil political rights, rights of the second generation are social, economic and cultural rights. There are differences between two. For instance, the United States of America do not recognize the economic, social and cultural rights. They only recognize civil and political rights. Great Britain does the same, Australia does the same, and so on and so on. There are still countries who have this. They are not cynical. They don't say there is no hunger in the world or there is no discrimination against women in the world and children are not starving and not going to school. It's not a cynical American. I was long time, 8 years, the first rapporteur for right to food at the Human Rights Council. I had to fight against five American ambassadors from three administrations. They all refused to recognize the right to food. They voted against any one of my reports, any recommendation and so on, the agrarian reform and so on and so on. Not by cynicism, but they said that the argument to refuse social and economic rights is to say they are evolutionary rights. Hunger, for instance. The right of personal integrity, for instance, which is a human right in the Declaration. It is an immediate realizable right. If somebody is tortured, it has to stop. There is violation, you have to forbid and impede torture, point, to stop it. But hunger is also, you can die also, or you die from hunger, we come to the point afterwards. But there is a process. You cannot just say, I forbid hunger, point on, you know, and bring to court the policeman who, you know, torture. Government can forbid torture, church in court, a policeman who tortures, and then it's finished, and free the prisoner. But if a child is hungry, say the American, it's the American theory, say the American, then you are faced with a process, You have to develop, the economy has to develop to produce more food, to produce an alternative social system, to assure distribution of food. It's not just the government cannot awake at 8 o'clock in the morning and say, today there shall be, from today on, there will be no hunger, no undernourishment in my country, point. So the evolutionary realization, say the Americans, is the difference, And this cannot be normatively solved by a decision of the United Nations or the Human Rights Council. It has to do with the market, with the development of forces and so on. I completely contest this theory, but this we will see perhaps in the discussion later. But still, the gap is very great between the two attitudes today. Now I come to the end of the historical part. 2005, there was a big crisis in the Commission. The Human Rights Commission, who elaborated and published this Universal Declaration, went on then after Paris, after Paris 48, until 2005, as the vigilante group, as the control instance for this Universal Declaration. The Commission had the charge to control all the member states. Now there are 194 member states of the United Nations, not 61 like in Paris. 194 member states. The Commission had then the charge until 2005 to control the application, the respect of this Universal Declaration by the member states. And every new member states, the Arab Emirates, Switzerland, and so on, who becomes member, applies for membership of the United Nations, has distinctly to sign two documents, the Charter of 45 and the Human Rights Declaration, to respect the two documents. And if they do so, and they are admitted to the United Nations, they are full member of the United Nations. So they are other juridical subtleties. For instance, Palestine signed voluntarily, is not member, full member of the United Nations, but by the civilization of Palestine, by the cultural heritage of Palestine, by the respect and solidarity, which are the fundamental values of Palestine society, they signed, they accepted voluntarily the principle of the Charter and the Human Rights Declaration. So there is, the human rights have, how you say, an efficiency outside even the organization of the United Nations. Okay, I come back. September 2005. Kofi Annan was then Secretary General of the United Nations, his last year, and he declared the dissolution of the Commission of Human Rights. Dissolution of the Commission of Human Rights. Because this Human Rights Commission was completely blocked. The most of the Arab countries, of the African countries, many Asian countries, they said the Western power are using human rights for neo-colonialist goals, you know? They live in a double standard, The Americans torture in Guantanamo and attack this and this Arab state for torture, you know? That's the double language. That's completely double language. Israel is occupying Palestine, not respecting any of the resolutions of the commission, any. There is not one. You cannot sign one of the resolutions. Committing torture, every human rights violation is protected by the Western power. This is double standard, which is against universality, indivisibility, and interdependence of all human rights. So the commission was blocked. They didn't even talk anymore in a constructive way together. The Europeans said it was Darfur, for instance, who was... the Europeans said, we should send, condemn the Sudan and send blue helmets to Darfur to stop the Sudanese army terrorizing the Sagwa, the Fur, and the Marsali, the three African people. It should stop by the intervention of the United Nations. So the majority of the Southern Hemisphere countries said, that's hypocrisy, because you don't send blue helmets to Palestine. You don't say, where the same violations are committed every day, you know? So the resolution on Darfur was refused by the majority of the southern countries, and the resolution on Palestine was also refused, and the two crimes go on. Palestine is still occupied, Israel is still torturing, colonizing, and so on. And in Darfur, women are still violated, and children die from hunger, and so on, and so on. So it was full paralysis, not just, I insist on this, not just academically, you know, the debate on social political rights. It was really, world community was paralyzed. And Kofi Annan said, this commission has to be dissolved. And September 2005 dissolved the commission. And in March 2006, the General Assembly created a new instance, the Council of Human Rights. The Council of Human Rights, which you will meet, I think, in your program. I mean, you will meet, you met the president already, who is from Gabon now.
Tomorrow.
Huh?
Tomorrow?
Yeah. Tonight, tomorrow?
Tomorrow,
I'll meet him. Tomorrow, okay. He can explain this. I don't know if he knows anything, but he can explain it. So, the Commission of the abolished, Council of Human Rights was instituted with much more powers, The Universal Review, you will talk about this. He is permanently seated in Geneva, comes together four times a year, 4 weeks, and so on, has an advisory group where I'm a member, vice president, and so on, and so on, and the new epoch started. But the conflict between social and economic rights, civil and political rights, still goes on, but the paralysis more or less stopped. So I have 10 minutes to present to you the right, one of these social, economic, and human rights, which is the most important. It's the right to food. It's the right to food. I read you the definition of the right to food. You know, professors, they like to read. And they love to read their own books, you know. Their own books. So I wrote a book, and those problems, Betting on Famine, which just came out in New York. I'm writing in French, naturally, but that's the translation. Betting on Famine, Why the World Still Goes Hungry. And the center says they will buy this book and give it to you, which would be a good thing, because it's a very good book. It's ironic. I read you the definition of the right to food. The human right to food is the right to have regular, permanent, and unrestricted access, either directly or by means of financial purchases, to quantitatively and qualitatively adequate and sufficient food, corresponding to the cultural traditions of the people to which the consumer belongs, and which ensure a physical and mental, individual and collective, fulfilling and dignified life free of fear. That's the definition. Pardon?
Can you repeat it again, please?
Pardon?
Can you repeat it, please?
Repeat it again. Repeat it.
My English is very bad. That's what you say. No? That's what you want to say.
Repeat that definition.
But you will find it in the book. But if ever they... That's why I said you should buy the gift the book, because there are all the figures in it and so on, you know? Okay. I repeat. Can you have some water? Because... thank you very much. Ah, that's better. I will repeat it right away. Yeah? Mm-hmm. But my English is not very good. That's the problem. Huh?
It's fine.
You are very kind. Very diplomatic. I read again. Huh? The right to food. The right is the right to have regular, permanent, and unrestricted access, either directly or by means of financial purchases, to quantitatively and qualitatively adequate and sufficient food, corresponding to the cultural traditions of the people to which the consumer belongs, and which ensure a physical and mental, individual and collective, fulfilling and dignified life free of fear. So this is the human right which is the most brutally, most permanently violated on this planet. I give you the figure of FAO, of the Specialized Organization of the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, of 2013. Every 5 seconds on this planet, a child below 10 dies from hunger. 57,000 people die from hunger every day. And almost 1 billion out of the 7.8 billion people we are on the planet are permanently, gravely undernourished. 1 billion who is invalid, have no sexual, no familiar, no work life, are mutilated, invalidated by permanent, grave undernourishment. The continent who has the most victims is Asia. 652 million people are gravely, permanently undernourished. But if you take the continental population in relation to the victims, then it's Africa. 35.2% of the African population, continental population, North Africa to South Africa, is gravely, permanently undernourished, and the curve is growing. And the same World Food Report, which gives every year the figures of the victims of this daily massacre, and nobody contests the numbers, the same World Food Report says that world agriculture, in its present development of its production forces, could nourish normally 2,200 calories per day per adult person, could nourish normally 12 billion people, almost a double of world humanity. So for the first time today in this new century, there is no fatality anymore. Famine, hunger, destruction, massacre accompanied humanity from the beginning, long time. But today, there is no objective need, there is no objective lack. It's a problem of distribution, not of production. The people die from hunger because they have no access to food which exists. It's not a problem of objective lack of food. So the conclusion is, a child who dies from hunger now, as we are talking, is assassinated by the capitalist, cannibalistic world order, which of the financial oligarchies, multinational companies and so on, who dominates this planet. So we have no time because the discussion is important. I just want to give some examples of the murderous mechanism who are killing the people, who are responsible for hunger. Just to give you some examples. It cannot be exhaustive. Some examples. For instance, the stock speculation on commodity stock speculation is driving up since 2 or 3 years the prices of staple food. I can give you an example from the last World Food Report. You know what is staple food? It means maize, rice, and wheat. Maize, rice, and wheat, who cover 75% of world consumption. 75% of the people of the world basically eat either maize, wheat, or rice. That means staple food. So I just take these three items. In the last 3 years, maize, the world price of maize, exploded and went up 63%. The world price of rice, 31.8%. And the ton of wheat doubled from $120 to $270. Because of speculation. You know that in 2008 there was a financial crash. The bandits of the great banks, they speculated to make even more money. And then there was the financial crash. From 2000 to 2008, the big hedge funds, for instance, they migrated from the financial markets to the commodity markets. Very concretely, for instance, from the New York Stock Exchange, where you buy shares and bonds and so on, to the Chicago Commodity Stock Exchange, where you deal in maize, wheat, rice, soja, oil, and so on and so on. They migrated because they lost so much money in the financial markets. And there, completely legally, in the Commodity Stock Exchange, they make incredible profits by speculating on staple food. You cannot lose because everybody has to eat. So if you speculate on staple food, you can only win. But the consequence is astronomic profits for some because the prices rise naturally through speculation, and tens of millions of victims more in the shanty towns of the world. World Bank statistic, as you know, 1 billion people live in the United Nations. They speak like the military. It's incredible, the vocabulary. They speak informal habitats, which means the favela of Rio, the slums of Karachi, the Smoky Mountains of Manila, and so on, which means the shanty towns, where people have almost no money, produce nothing, 1 billion people, and have to buy their daily food with very, very little money. It's very little money. So if the price of rice exploded, but the mother, and cannot buy enough because she has not money. And people, I give you an anecdote. I was recently in Bolivia, where a formidable revolution takes place now. In Bolivia, the plane comes down at 4,200 meters, you know, El Alto, and La Paz is down in the volcano. So I always, when I go to Bolivia, I stop in Lima, which is down at the Pacific coast. And in Lima, I know, because there the Som and Oxfam, I know a shanty town, one of the Calampas, what you call Calampas. I was there from the dawning of the sun at 4 o'clock in the afternoon to look at the queuing of the mothers, you know, they queuing up before the rice depot, the first rice deposit. I stayed until midnight, from 4 o'clock in the afternoon until midnight, looking as these mothers trying to buy some food. I didn't see one Peruvian woman who bought only 1 kilo of rice. How many children she may have at home. They bought the rice in little plastic cups, little plastic cups, you know, because he could not pay more. Then the mother goes home, makes fire under the under the pot, yes, makes fire. When the water boils, she empties the cup, and then you have boiling water and some grains of rice, you know, floating on the water. And that's the alimentation for the children for the day. So naturally they perish. That's the direct consequences of the speculation of hedge funds, big banks and so on, financial groups, on the commodity stock exchanges, on staple food, on staple food today. You are in Geneva. Geneva today is the European headquarter of the speculative hedge funds on commodities. Because there are fiscal privilege, there is free convertibility, banking secrecy, and so on and so on. And here, very near here at Rue de Rhône, the big banks, the big hedge funds and so on, they are the people who by computer kill every day millions of people. Hundreds of thousands of people, in a month there may 15 millions. Totally legally. I insist on it because there is a television I insist on it. I had enough court procedure on my back. My parliamentary immunity was taken away from me. I was condemned 9 times for a book I wrote. Switzerland washes weiter, and so on and so on. So I say it again, facing this camera, this speculation on staple food is totally legal. It's totally legal by existing law, but it is morally unacceptable. And it is murderous. That's one mechanism. Who kills? Then second mechanism who kills is the agrarian dumping of the European Union. You know that the European Union is sending its overproduction with great subsidies, for instance, to Africa. On any African market, the Sandaga in Dakar, in Niamey, in Bamako, you can buy French, Greek, German, Italian tomatoes, poulet, comment tu dis poulet? Chicken, potatoes, fruits, and so on. For half, for one certain price of qualitatively corresponding African products, and some kilometers from the market, from the city, you have the African peasant with his wife, with his children, working 10 hours a day under the burning sun, working like slaves, and the African peasant has not the least chance to get a revenue. Really. So the hypocrisy of the commissioners in Brussels, of the African Union, is abyssal. They fabricate hunger in Africa and they throw back into the sea the refugees from hunger who tried to come to Lampedusa or through the Atlantic route to the Canary Island. You know, that's European hypocrisy. Fabricating hunger in Africa and then throw back to the sea the survivors who try to come to the southern frontier of the fortress of the European Union. That's the second mechanism, the agrarian dumping. The third mechanism is the foreign debt, naturally, is the foreign debt. I have 5 minutes more than I stop. No? Oui? Je peux? No, it's better not to talk too much. Professors always talk too much. The third, he agrees, you see. He says, yes, it's like this. Yeah, he agrees to it. So, the third one is the foreign debt, naturally. This 122 third world countries last year had accumulated foreign debt of $2,100 billion. So for the poorest country, for instance, Mali or Niger or Sierra Leone or Bangladesh or Mongolia and so on, for the poorest country, the foreign debt is like garro. How do you say garro? Garro.
Loose.
Huh? Yes. Is étouffé. Come to the étouffé. Étouffé. It's strangled. It's like a strangulation. It's like a strangulation. There are 54 countries on the African continent. 54 countries. 37 of them are poor agriculture countries. Agriculture countries. The investment, public investment in agriculture for the 54 African countries last year was 4%. Was 4%. It is 31% in Europe. Which means that the government, whoever is in power, they are horrible, corrupt people in power in some African countries. But there are also very good governments in power in some African countries, you know? In Algeria and so on, they're very good. Whoever the government is, they have not the means to invest in irrigation, in seeds, in transport, in local markets, in pesticides, and so on and so on. They cannot, they have not the money, because all they earn by the export of a little bit of cotton and so on goes directly to the World Monetary Fund or to the creditor banks in Paris, New York, and London, or Zurich, you know, directly. As interests of the loan, as amortization of the loan, and so on. They have not the money to invest in their own agriculture. Also, there are agriculture countries. The consequence of it is that the 54 African states last year, 54, which means the continent and the belonging islands, you know, Madagascar and so on. They had to import also, they are majority agriculture countries with very good soil, with very old peasant civilization. The Wolof, the Bambara, the Pearls and so on, they are the oldest civilization of the world, very competent with meteorological logic, with working very hard and so on. These countries had to import for $24 billion from the world market, rice and wheat. And as the prices explode, they cannot import enough. And more people are dying. So the foreign debt is a third murderous mechanism creating hunger. So my last remark I want to say. There is no fatality. You are young, intellectual people starting in life. You are absolutely, totally privileged because you study at a great university. You are absolutely privileged. You will have jobs in diplomacy, in government, everywhere. You must know and be persuaded, because it's true, there is no objective need for the daily massacre of hunger. It can be stopped tomorrow because any one of these mechanism. I just told you defined three of them. There are others which we can discuss afterwards. Is man-made, is made by man, and can be broken by man, by human beings, by collective action. Can be broken by collective action. Tomorrow, no stock exchange in the world is functioning without a normative framework. There is in every country of the world where commodity stock is negotiated, there is a law on commodity stock. It can be changed tomorrow. Parliament, for instance, can decide one article more, are forbidden speculation, financial speculation on staple food, which are maize, wheat and rice, from anybody who is not a producer and not a consumer of the staple food. Point. Is forbidden. Majority of Parliament is voting till the law is revised and the speculation stops. Secondly, the foreign debt. When the World Monetary Fund General Assembly comes together next May in Washington, we can force our finance minister to declare void the foreign debt of the 50th least developed countries of the world. This is a category defined in the United Nations vocabulary. As to give these countries the possibility to invest in their own agriculture. Because most of the country where hunger is worst have the objective means, soil, peasants, climate, to get very quickly, to attain very quickly autosufficiency, alimentary sovereignty, as we call it. You know? Agrarian dumping of the European Union. There are 28 states today of the European Union, 422 million of people living in the European Union. Switzerland doesn't want to be there because they want the banking secrecy. But it's potentially the most powerful economic space in the world. We can force our agriculture ministers, when they come together in Brussels, to stop agrarian dumping, to not subsidize anymore food exports of excedentary food to African, Asian or Caribbean markets. This can be done. There is absolutely no fatality. If I may conclude with a citation of a French writer who says, God has no other hands as ours. God has no other hands than ours. Either we change this murderous world order or nobody does it. And you have to change it. Voilà, thank you.